nature called the miracle of the seven loaves and fishes, where Jesus feeds 4,000. And this is recorded in two of the four Gospels, Matthew and Mark, but not in Luke and John. This should not really be a concern for us because, you know, the different Gospel writers had different objectives and audiences. And they wanted to communicate the life and work of Jesus. After all, John writes in chapter 21, Jesus did many other things as well. And if every one of them were written down, I suppose that even the whole world would not have enough room for the books that would be written. So the feeding of the 5,000 is a significant moment in Jesus' ministry and in proclaiming who he is. Right, Matthew chapter 14. I'm just going to start off with a little bit of him and then I'll jump into John. So in chapter 14, Matthew, it describes the following event. Jesus and his disciples have just heard that John the Baptist has been beheaded. After a foolish promise by King Herod given to his stepdaughter during a drunken birthday party. Jesus was clearly upset and troubled by this event and withdraws by a private boat or a boat privately to a solitary place. It is quite understandable that Jesus would want to get away and privately grieve the loss of his familial relative. Wouldn't we want to do something similar? You know, a loss of a loved one. Let's escape. Let's have some private mourning. Alas, things were not to be. And in verse 13 of Matthew, it reads, "Hearing of this, the crowds follow him on foot from the towns." So goodbye, peace and quiet, and a time of private grieving. So what is Jesus' response to this intrusion of privacy? When Jesus landed, he saw a large crowd. He had compassion on them, and he healed their sick. You may wish to think and reflect upon what your response would be in a similar circumstance. I don't think compassion would be on my heart at that time. Well, it wouldn't be. We're all on journeys, okay? This is about our hearts. Jesus' heart is always full of genuine love and compassion. He sees us and has compassion for us, no matter whether it is convenient to him or not. This is not some sickly, condescending love that Jesus has, a looking down upon others and thinking, "You poor thing." Remember that Jesus, the Good Shepherd, and we've kind of had echoes of this today already, knows each one of us individually by name. He loves us. He loves you. He loves you as if you were the only person who ever existed. Have a think about that before I move on. He loves you as if you were the only person who ever existed. Do you believe that? If we struggle, we all struggle at times receiving that. That's one of the reasons why I tend to go to new wine, because I tend to hear that. And sometimes we need help of the Lord to help us to receive his personal love for us. Now, we're going to look in a bit more detail to the main event of this story, this sermon, the feeding of the 5,000. And we can assume the following description or account took place sometime shortly after Jesus had been ministering to the crowd. So this is John chapter 6, 3-5. "Then Jesus went up on a mountainside and sat down with his disciples. And when Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming towards him, he said to Peter, 'Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat. So you could almost picture it. He got off his boat. He's troubled. He's grieving. Massive multitude of people there. He ministers to them and heals their sick. And then he goes up on this kind of mountainside. And then he's looking down and he's just seeing 5,000 men plus women and children. So 15,000 people. And he turns to Philip. Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat? Now Philip was, he was a local lad. Philip was from a nearby town of Bethsaida. And it would have been appropriate to ask a local lad where he could get bread to feed this great crowd on the mountainside. So he turns around to the local lad. Where should we get bread for these people? Placing yourself in Philip's shoes, how would you have responded to a similar question put to you by Jesus? Where we see the scale of need in Bushmead or Luton, for example, how do we respond to such circumstances? What is our default setting? That's normally the truthful bit in our hearts. What is our first response when we see need? Well, this is how Philip responded. Eight months' wages would not buy enough for each one. He'd probably be a bit more exasperated and emotional, and his probably hands would go up. I would probably take a big, deep breath at this point, almost like overwhelmed. Overwhelmed. What are we going to do? Hands up. Do you trust Jesus? Do you trust Jesus in your own personal life? Do you trust him? Why do you trust him? If you do, why? Why do you trust him? If you know the reason why you really trust him, then you will not need all the facts and figures and the answer for this particular time or whatever the circumstances. If you really trust him, you do not need all the facts and figures and answers. And this will strengthen you. Do you trust Jesus even when things don't make sense? And there's a lot of things that don't make sense. Philip saw the problem before him and he was overwhelmed. The scale of the problem, those 15,000 people or whatever, overwhelmed him. Aren't we often like Philip when we see the scale of the problems before us? We too can feel overwhelmed. And then just imagine how Philip would have felt and perhaps possibly responded to the following. Well, there's a boy over here with 5 loaves and 2 small fish. 15,000 people, give or take. And then you almost want to be mischievous at this point. Well, there's a boy over here. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish. How can that not be a joke? How can that be a joke? 15,000 people, 5 loaves and 2 fish. Is that serious? Well, I mean, Philip wouldn't have taken the joke, okay? No one would in those circumstances. No, and my humour would have evaporated long ago since if I was in that situation. How can this not be a joke? Something so meagre compared with the scale of actual need facing him. In our own similar personal situations and trials and difficulties, You know, sometimes we kind of think, well, perhaps I'm not clever enough for this situation. I can't sort it out. I can't afford to sort out this problem. I don't have enough time. I don't have the experience or the spiritual gifts. My house isn't big enough. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. Sometimes we are looking for excuses and reasons not to intervene and play our part in the solution. 5 loaves and 2 small fish is a joke compared with the scale of need before Philip and the other disciples. But Jesus already knows what the answer is going to be. And if you turn to verse 6, it says the following. Jesus asked this question, "Where shall we buy bread?" Only to test Philip, for he already had in mind what he is going to do. So how do you feel about that? How about that? Jesus already knows what he's going to do in every situation. Do you trust Jesus? Do you really trust him to be the answer to the problems we face, both individually and as a church community, regardless of the scale of the problem? If we trust Jesus and know the reasons why we trust him, then this will be our strength. He's looking at our heart and what our response is going to be. Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. Now, Revelation 3:13 has been on my heart for quite a while. And I've spoken about this a couple of times at church. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power. When? Forever and ever. Now, God the Father is kind of not a person as such, and he probably doesn't have a throne that he actually sits on. He's not sitting like that on the throne, okay? So it's a figurative thing. But that is, if you sit on the throne, you have power. Everyone else comes before you and they stand or they're kneeling. He is sitting on the throne. That's what Revelation is about. He is not stressed or anxious or worried. He's sitting on the throne with the Lamb, the Lord God Almighty. And be praise and honor and glory and power be with him forever and ever. Now, sometimes we forget that God is the God of the universe. He is a big, big God. As the, I put here children's worship song, but you called it something else this morning. All-age song, that was the word, wasn't it? It's an all-age song. Okay, he is a big, big God. I love that song. There's theology in that. We limit God. We have limited expectations of what he can do and what he will do. In fact, I'm not sure we think our God is particularly very big sometimes. So why is that? Is it because the scale of the problems before us are overwhelming us? And our hands go up. Is it because we haven't seen God move significantly in our own lives or in the lives of those around us? Is that maybe like an evidence thing, perhaps? I just haven't seen it. Perhaps we're not inviting God into those things. We're not asking him. We're not praying. Have we simply diverted our gaze to the problems around us and leave it to others to sort out? Perhaps we run away or or harden our hearts to the voice of Jesus calling to us to be involved in things that he is already doing. And that's the skill, that's the key, isn't it? To do the things that he is already doing. It's not come and join my party, God, this is where I want to go. It's what he is already doing. Have we hardened our hearts to what Jesus is calling us to do? Here is a boy with five small barley loaves and two small fish. And then verse 11, which is John 6, Jesus then took the loaves, he gave thanks, he distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted, and he did the same with the fish. This is the miracle of multiplication. Jesus took the loaves and fish, the meager five loaves and two fish, the meager resources we have, and he gave thanks for it, and then he distributed it to the crowd who are seated on the grass. Now, literally, we see Jesus being the good shepherd that I preached on a couple of times this year. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He settles me down on green pastures. He is the good shepherd, literally, in that person. That scripture, that Psalm 23, it came to life at that time. And the New Testament is full of Jesus really being that good shepherd. And the good shepherd knows his sheep of his pasture. Jesus, the good shepherd, knows our true needs. We are his sheep. We are his church. And we belong to him. So how do we specifically apply this to the situation here at Christchurch? This is the application. Now, Christchurch is having a tough time at the moment, aren't we? Now, it's not having elephants in the room. Elephants are rubbish. We see them, okay? It's tough. Being an adult is tough. I've said this before. You know, we're out of puberty at Christchurch now. We're way on our way in terms of adulthood. Okay, we're young adults, if you think about the life of the church. You know, at school, and I think about this with my own students, you know, we tend to think, oh, it's been great being an adult, and it is great being an adult, but it actually is quite hard as well, isn't it? And it's not always fun and games. There are fun and games of being an adult, but it isn't always like that. It is tough. It is hard. So why wouldn't we be like that as Christ Church? From November, we no longer have a vicar. We are also, and the church already knows this, is struggling financially. Our income is roughly £2,500 less than our expenditure per month. That is equivalent to around £50 short in income for every person per month at Christchurch. How do you feel about that? Now, there are several responses to a situation like that we have in Christchurch. We can respond like Philip and be totally overwhelmed by that problem. Hands in the air, oh my goodness. We can respond like the little child in verse 9. Here is a boy with five small barley loaves and two small fish. We can try, another response would be to try and sort this problem out in our own strength. And do you know what happens if we do that? We become disillusioned and we'll become burnt out. That is what's going to happen if we try and do this in our own strength. There are already people disillusioned and burnt out in this church. Okay, I don't think God wants people to be burnt out. I just simply do not believe that. It says that God gives us what we can bear. doesn't overwhelm us. I think we kind of bring that on ourselves sometimes by not being obedient or doing too much. I think sometimes we pick up too much. We can try and sort this out in our own strength and become disillusioned and burnt out. Let's not be that. Let's not do it that way. And we can obediently, as an alternative, we can obediently work with Jesus and give with our hearts. Now, John 6, verse 6 is quite interesting. It's an interesting phrase there, or term. And it says that Jesus only asked Philip, where should they buy bread for these people to eat? Because he wanted to, and here it is, test him. What if we at Christchurch are being tested at this moment? What about that? In fact, it's even more blunt in Mark. In Mark 6:37, Jesus turned around to the disciples, which is the same story, the same encounter. You give them something to eat. You give them something to eat. What if God is testing and waiting to see how we will respond first? What if God is testing and waiting for us to respond with our hearts? Now, Malcolm McDonald, one of the keynote speakers at New Wine this summer, spoke about the missing revival. And I will speak more about this in the future. But Malcolm McDonald says, that God often uses times of trial to draw us back to him. If you spend any time in the Old Testament, you will see that again and again and again. God doesn't want us to be to wander off, to do things in our own strength. He wants us back. He wants us to be with him. John 15, verse 5. Apart from me, you can do nothing. That's the danger for Christchurch, okay? Apart from me. Apart. There's God, we're doing it our way. Apart from him, we can do nothing. And there's a real danger in that. That's not in my notes. And again, go away and think about this and pray for it. I'm not saying we're in this situation. But what if we have been apart from God? What if that this situation is the result of trying to do it our own way? What if? Apart from me, you can do nothing. In light of Christchurch's financial situation, I'd like you to prayerfully consider the next points I'm going to make. I mean, there are the emails, and if you're not on the emails, I'll post it out to you if you give me your email address, or it'll be on it'll be uploaded onto YouTube. So pray about the following. I'd like you to prayerfully review your current regular, weekly or monthly giving to the church. And the church leadership usually reminds the congregation about this time of year, every year, to take stock of what's happened, where are we, what's happened to our finances. As disciples of Christ, we are each of us called to practice tithing, which is about 10% of our income. If you're not currently tithing, then I would encourage you to prayerfully start giving. And one way of doing this is to start at 1% of income and then increase by additional 1% over a period of time, perhaps over 12 months. Again, that came out of one of the keynote speakers at New Wine this year. because that's about faith. The little boy gave 5 loaves and 2 fish. He did not give his he didn't give after he had eaten his share of the food first. He didn't give Jesus his leftovers, the fish heads and the few half-eaten crusts. He offered what he had willingly, unconditionally, sacrificially. Now, I'm not saying I don't do that, and that's a kind of a conviction thing for me. Okay. How do you think he felt, this small boy, when he saw what Jesus did with his offering? What a blessing that would have been to that small boy. Just think about that, what that miracle would have done to his level of faith. You know, God is not expecting us to hand over all our money. But he is looking at our hearts when we decide whether to give or not, and how the attitude in which we give. Now, Glyn has already mentioned, it's on the notes as well. So next Sunday, the 23rd of September, Christchurch is holding its annual gift, Harvest Gift Day. And Gift Day is financially giving over and above our regular, weekly, monthly financial giving. It is, again, an act of faith. It is a giving thanks to God in response to what he has done for us. It's a sacrifice. And it will be used for the mission and operation of Christchurch as it seeks to make fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, and for us to serve and bless Bushmead as we witness the good news of Jesus Christ. I think that's on the notice sheets at the bottom. Please prayerfully consider your financial offering for this year's Harvest Gift Day. So in conclusion, Jesus asked Philip, "Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?" Christchurch, what are we going to do during the time we are without a vicar? What are we going to do? Christchurch, what are we going to do about that £2,500 monthly shortfall? Are we going to respond to the situation as Philip did, by being overwhelmed? Are we going to do this in our own strength and become burnt out and disillusioned? Are we going to respond like that little boy and offer Jesus his loaves and his fish? What are the loaves and fishes that we are going to offer Jesus when he asks us to give? What are we going to offer? At New Wine, I was given a word of encouragement. It was also a little rebuke as well, which I received faithfully. Let God be God. Let God be God. Let's not be God in Christchurch. Let's not step on his toes. Let God be God. We are Christ's church. Jesus already knows what he's going to do here in this church. He already knows. Is this a test? Are we going to work with him and step into the plans he already has for us? Are we going to step into that? Jesus is waiting for our response. What is that going to be? Amen.
We're going to stand now for our concluding worship. Oh yeah, during which we will take the offering.